After watching Steve Zura and Kelly's videos on foam casting, I decided to give it a try myself. This video is not only about that, but it's also about preparing the furnace, inspecting the crucible, and whether the crucibles are safe to use or not if you're using metal ones. It's been a while since I've run my furnace, so I'm going to need to warm it up slowly by lighting a small fire in it and then slowly bringing it up to temperature. Now, some of the experienced casters have probably seen some problems by now. At first, the metal crucible. You don't want to be using a metal crucible because they can fail without warning. Second, you don't want to put anything in there that's wet. The water problem is easily solved, but putting it in a really hot place and letting the water vaporize the steam. There have been many tragedies over the years, but putting something wet in the molten crucible and it sinks to the bottom and blows up. As for the crucible, I'd highly recommend you buy a proper crucible and not use a metal one. Now, these are my test subjects today, which I might add, they do fail, but there is a lot to be learned by my failures. Once again, I'm back using the cheap clay sand. However, I did go to the store and grab some better sand, and in the next video, hopefully it'll work out even better. This part was covered in a light coating of plaster. Now, we'll talk about it more in the next video, but this worked out quite well. However, venting did become a problem for it. Now, Lostfoam casting is easy, as literally putting the foam parts in the pail and then packing the sand down around it. And by packing the sand, I mean putting the sand in and then just banging the pail on the ground until the sand packs down. Also, part of the experiment today is to check to see if the pencil graphite that I had put in the parts were going to leave a drilled hole in the part. Off of one of Steve's ideas of using soup cans, however, I'm going to use a Coke can or beer can. I'm just temporarily heating it up to get all the moisture out of it. Now, the reason why I'm using a pop can or a beer can is simple. After the casting, I can just throw it back in the pot and remelt it all. Now, this is the second time I've done Lostfoam casting, and it seems very counterintuitive that the sand isn't really packed down with anything and you pour the aluminum in. However, I assure you it does work, but there are some hesitation factors about doing Lostfoam casting, and I wouldn't recommend it for the faint of heart, let alone using a plastic pail, which you'll see here in a minute. But I'm not one to get bogged down with technicalities, like safety or anything like that. There was definitely a lot more slag than usual for this pour, because I used a lot of junk metal that had a lot of extras in it. And this was a bit of a cooler pour for the metal going into the foam. Remember, casting is a dangerous game, however you do it. And you should be wearing full PPE. Check out the notes below for the minimum PPE you should be wearing. And you see this hesitation here? This hesitation here probably caused the failure of one of my parts. With Lostfoam casting, you can't pause during the pour. If you pause and it runs out of metal, the sand will collapse. Secondly, I wouldn't suggest pouring on snow because there is a chance that the metal will spit. However, the snow does work quite well as an extinguishing agent. Now, let's cool all this junk off. Let's take it out and see where we went wrong, what worked and what didn't work. Right out of the gates, I can tell you one thing that went wrong, aside from all the safety violations. I didn't pour enough aluminum in the risers. This, in turn, didn't allow the aluminum to get down below. If it had worked proper, that straw wouldn't be there, and it would have been replaced by aluminum. It's always like Christmas morning when you dump out the pail to see what kind of parts you have. I almost feel like I'm getting coal for Christmas. Now, let's pull these parts out and have a closer look. This first one was covered in a light coating of plaster, and you can see the detail where I even wrote on it. Now, this next part's pretty cool. I took some graphite from a lead pencil and put it in there. We'll have a better look at this after we clean it up. Now, keep in mind water expands 1,800 times its size. I think we almost had a problem here if you see the bubble. It almost spit up at me. In the future, I think we're going to shoot for a dry area instead of doing it over snow. But back to the successes. The graphite was a little bit of a challenge to get out from where it was. However, it did come out. I think this worked out quite well because aluminum pours a lot cooler than some of the other metals, but I don't think this would work for bronze, which was originally my intent. It did, however, make a perfectly sized hole, just like I had hoped, except for the screwdriver got stuck on the one side because I was a little overzealous. As for the plastered covered side, it looks quite good. I mean, you can actually see the polystyrene. And check out the fine detail on the hole. Next, coming up, let's try doing it a little bit differently with better gating, a lot more safety, and see how that goes from there.